Okay, today's project is disassembling a Dell monitor, an older one. This is a model number, 2005FPW, and it comes on one of those extending and rotating mounts. Symptoms on this are it just wouldn't turn on, quote unquote. This is actually for my wife's work computer, and so I'm trying to fix it so she can get back to a dual screen setup. So far, I am not impressed with this monitor. Let's take a look at the construction here. You drop the four VESA screws in the back, and then there seemed to be nothing else. There were two small slots on the side here for a spudger. Now, I don't have a spudging tool, but working slowly and carefully, and I do mean carefully, with some screwdrivers and fine jeweler screwdrivers, I've managed to get it open. But based on what I've read online and digging around, these idiots glue the front panel buttons to the tops of the circuit board in there when it's assembled. The other thing that is crap about this, in slowly prying, and I was even just using my fingers here, part of the case broke, chipped away, because of the way these little catches are in there. And it looks like there was a bead of glue that was run around. That is corporate stupidity. If the VP who decided this was a good idea and this was how it was going to be put together is watching this, you get in contact with me and I will tell you to your face how much of a moron you are. This is retarded. This is not serviceable. So, my next step is to try to disconnect this delicate little ribbon cable so I don't tear it, and then I will work to get the circuit board loose from those buttons, and I will try to get the rest of the front bezel off, and go from there with the disassembly. But so far, I am not impressed with this. The fact that a monitor this expensive, and with all these inputs, DVI, VGA, looks like S-video, RCA plug, maybe HDMI, USB, failed. And I can guarantee you, without even getting any further, that it's capacitors. The design is probably okay, but they probably thought they were saving money by putting in s*** capacitors. Cheap Chinese junk. Don't do that. Spend the extra damn dollar and put in, I don't know, Panasonic, good Japanese capacitors, good brand, reliable brand. And you know what? You want to mark it up by $5 so I don't ever have to tear it apart or ever have to work on it? We'll call it a deal. Until then, you're a nitwit. You're a moron. I doubt it's the design engineer's fault. It was somebody later who cheaped out. But let's try to get the rest of this apart and see how it goes here. Okay, finally was able to work stupid-ass plastic bezel off. The only way to do it was to work along and pry outwards. The problem is they've made this plastic too brittle, and I've chipped it in two places. I'm not happy about that. That is not good quality work. Now, let's see if this allows the plastic back to come off here. Okay. That comes apart all right. I don't want to disassemble any more than I absolutely have to. The only way to get this connector out was to actually pull on it gently on the blue reinforcing, the pair of needle nose pliers. No amount of fiddling with the connector on the tiny circuit board was able to get the connector to release. These look like they're just sprung on there. So let me switch out now. Yeah. Okay. Disassembling this. I hope I don't have to tear into it too far. I think it's these screws here on the side. Looks like there's two on each side, and then the back frame should lift off. Took out those four screws, and you can see there's a cable there, and there's several cables on the end. First of the ones on the end might be for the backlighting, and that's for the panel LVDI interface. The one thing it does allow you to do, let me get this back up on a tripod here, does allow you enough wiggle room to lift and turn. Now I should be able to get off the adhesive tape here. This, and it has two little spring clips. It should allow it to come out, which it doesn't. I'll play with that and see, but if I can get that undone, I should be able to lay the panel over. Let's see if I can undo these. There we go. So we undo the four connectors on the side. And now, I don't really have enough room to flip this up and over. There's a little keeper underneath here that I unhooked here. So, still not quite enough room to flip it clear. At least now I can get access to everything. Don't recognize the brand logo. Chances are there's some larger electrolytics on the back of the... This is the logic section that handles all the interfacing. All of the panel power stuff is in this larger board with the massive heat sink on it. Looks like four screws, and I should be able to flip that over. And then I'm willing to bet that's where some of the caps are going bad. I don't recognize this brand. They're definitely not like United Chemicon or Fujitsu or Samsung or any good brand. So some of these may be going out of tolerance too. Although based on the symptomology, I'm worried about the problems here. And given the power requirement of this to drive the old style inverter for the backlight, that's probably what caused them to fail. Looking at some pretty nasty solder joints. Hate it when they don't clean the flux properly. I don't see anything obviously burnt. So yeah, I'm sticking to my original diagnosis so far of probably out of tolerance or blown electrolytic caps. Let me get that apart and we'll proceed from there. There's also one Phillips head screw here beside the IEC power connector that seems to be holding part of the power assembly in place. That should be the only other thing holding this power board in. And there's a slot on the top here, or let me rephrase that, on this side that allows the IEC here, the IEC connector can slide up. Now there's a connector here that I want to take out, but I don't want to do that just yet. Go. And pretty standard one-sided through-hole construction. Nothing amazing. Looks like they've gobbed some Celastic around. Samyang instead of Samsung on one of these. Okay, I'm going to got the ground lead running across. I'm going to detach the ground lead where it's screwed into the frame assembly, and I'm going to pull this connector, and that way I can get the ground loose. Okay, to get the logic board out, there are two sheet metal screws that hold the frame to the major frame, four screws on the board itself, and then on the back side above the VGA connector, and over here, next to the USB connector, there are two more of the smaller sheet metal screws. And then that allows the whole piece to come out. The problem is I still have this LVDS cable that I cannot figure out how to get disconnected. And there's a secondary connector that runs off to the side USB board here. So I'm going to try to disconnect that and flop it this way so I can at least look at it and get to the underside in case I have to desolder some of these caps. This construction is really horrible and unfriendly, and I don't like the design. All right, so the diagnosis comes out that I found three caps on these boards using the ESR meter that are out of spec. One is way out of spec. I don't remember what value I got for which, but one of them was reading 99 ohms, and one of the other ones was reading about 8 ohms, and the other third one that was known bad was reading 2.7. And on the back of the meter, there's a little graph here. Everything should have been coming in well under 1 ohm that I measured. The other one that was out, that was 99 ohms, should have been reading about 6 or 7. So that was really screwed up. not surprised, given that these are Samyang capacitors instead of Samsung. Since I had it apart, I went through and made a list here of all the caps and the values that I'm going to go ahead and replace. Even though only three of them came out as iffy, as long as I've got it torn apart, I'm just going to swap these out. I went ahead and looked up the DigiKey numbers, and all totaled for these capacitors, it's about $6.50 from DigiKey. So that order's going in, and I'll just swap them out. But it's the classic ones that go bad on this. These two were out of tolerance on the power board. And I don't remember which one of these on the logic board. These are the two that always go, 635 and capacitor 637. If you dig around on Google or any of the forums on badcaps.net, for this model of monitor, these are always going. So I'm just going to go ahead and change them and fix them. The voltages that I checked, and boy, is it a pain in the butt with this monitor design. You have to take it all the way apart. And the way I ended up doing it was having everything connected except the logic cable to the display itself. I had all of the connectors plugged in off of the power board here that run the backlights. So all of the inverters would run because they won't run right without a load. And when I checked the voltages on the main connector between the logic board and the power supply board. Let me see if I can flip this over here. That connector is labeled, and I just went down and probed the voltages, and the 5 volt was fine, and the 12 volt was fine. The 3.3 volt was a little bit sketchy, and even the 5 volt was a little bit low. It was running 4.97, which normally I like to see it above 5, and on one of my measurements it was about 5.2. So I think the capacitors are messing up the regulation, but all of the voltage regulators are working, so that's not a problem, and I don't have to mess with those, fortunately. And the only thing I'm not changing out, all of these caps are getting changed, that one, these two. I'm not changing out the big one. Those tend not to fail. The other thing I did was I stipulated a slightly higher voltage for the two caps on the logic board. These are 16 volt. I'm going to go ahead and put in 25 volt in an equivalent package and rating. As soon as those come in, I'll desolder these and solder in the new ones and then put the panel back together, and we'll pick up from there. I finally found the manual online and downloaded the PDF. This is just the troubleshooting and schematics. But the front part of the manual PDF has instructions for removing this, and they actually show prying up that front bezel by prying away from the screen. So you get on the inside of the bezel and work your way around this way. I didn't want to do that because it seems like you're going to risk putting pressure on the screen, and they have all these warnings about, you know, don't push hard on the screen because you could damage the LCD. And I'm like, well, then you should have designed the frickin' bezel differently. But that was one thing I did wrong. The other thing is this connector that I had such trouble with, the brown piece flips up. I can show you this. Like a toolbox lid. And I didn't know that. It just clamps back down and clicks in place. Fortunately, I didn't damage the cable by horsing it out of there, but that's how that opens up. Okay, I just got all of the capacitors replaced. They're the old ones. Oops. That one is completely bad. I get no reading whatsoever. There's a couple, well, at least two that are known bad. One is completely dead. The other one is too high, and given that that's affecting voltage regulation, well, that's all she wrote. I've got all of these soldered back with their replacements. I'm using Panasonic's. I think these are FC series. I'd have to go back and look at my order form. But they're very low ESR. And in a couple places, I went from 16 volts to 25 volts with the same farad rating, just to make sure they would hold up, especially on the power supply. So, thanks to the Hacko 808 soldering gun, I made short work of this. I love this thing. I absolutely love this desoldering gun. It works so well. It's so much easier than dealing with the clickable solder sucker deal or, you know, solder wickering. Okay, now that these are all repaired and I've got all the new caps on and I've got the two replacement caps here, I ordered the wrong form factor, unfortunately, but it was no big deal. I was able to lay them over a little bit. Everything's in and everything checks out with the meter, so it's time to reassemble. So let me cut away and then cut. Time to try to get this sandwich back together in the panel here. Panel. Reconnect the video. This thing is a bit fiddly. I hope you can see this. Everything clicks back in place. There, which is the point of the tape. Now, get this all set back our side. Make sure you can see these. Clicky. Place. Now let me put the side screws in the unit. There are two here and two on the opposite side, so let me cut away and do that and then cut. Well, this sucks. I got the monitor completely reassembled. Let me plug it in here real quickly and watch the LEDs there. You should see them flash. Yep. So it gets power. I click the power button. Green light comes on. Give it a second. You get your display. And now that it's actually working and the backlight's working, you can see where the glass was cracked. So that entire quadrant is screwed. I am not happy with that at all. It looks like it was dropped on the side because of the way the cracks are. I'm very pissed off because I spent several hours diagnosing this and researching parts and ordering parts and getting them in. But, you know, there was no way to know the glass was cracked. You can't see this at all when I turn it back off. I mean, it just, you cannot tell. So it's only when that backlight comes on that you can see how screwed up things are. So I've called my wife, I've given her the bad news that my repair worked, but there was another problem and the glass is broken. So I don't know what they're going to want to do with this monitor. It's basically junk at this point, which is very sad. But it's good to know that the diagnosis was right. So if I get another monitor, I know which capacitors to look at. So not all ending as hoped, but thanks for watching. I hope that was informative. The one thing I will say about these Dell 2005 FPW model, they are crap design overall. Let me pull this back out. The plastic is garbage. There are the two pieces, and I wasn't prying very hard. I've torn equipment apart for years, and these just broke. And I had another piece come off when I was snapping the case back together. This popped out. That's just garbage construction. And the sad thing is, if they had not tried to save 50 cents and put in proper Panasonic or Nichicon capacitors, you know, a known good brand, there would have been no need to tear it apart. This panel would have worked for many more years. So, yeah, I hate junk. I really don't like Dell. So this is a successful failure, I guess you'd call it. But at least I found the problem and got it working. I don't know, maybe if they're going to throw it out, I'll use it as a junk monitor in the garage on an old laptop or something. But thanks for watching, and I'll see you next time.